Yes. Good evening. My name is Gary Prevo. I'm the program director for the Global Awareness Lecture Series. And we begin our year of programming with tonight's program, which for the eighth consecutive year is a partnership with an important United States non-governmental organization, Witness for Peace. This is an organization that I've had some relationship to, going all the way back to its founding in the 1980s when it began its work in a country that I was doing research in and very involved with politically, Nicaragua, specifically standing with people in Nicaragua who were under attack from a war that was financed from the United States. And from that work of Witness for Peace, it evolved into a long-standing organization working throughout our hemisphere with various programs in that same human rights work. They've expanded that work over time. And what they do for us each fall is bring to the United States, specifically to the upper Midwest, they bring a human rights activist. We have had activists last year, for example. Our program was people who organized the flower workers in Colombia. We've had those that have done organization of human rights work in Mexico, for example, in recent years. And tonight's program that brings Alfredo López to our campus zeroes in on the country of Honduras. We had a human rights activist here from Honduras 3 or 4 years ago, but tonight it will introduce us to a new community, the Afro-Indigenous community of Honduras and their particular struggles. I'm now going to introduce Gloria Jimenez from Witness for Peace, who will conduct the program. She will serve as the translator for our speaker. For those of you who are learning Spanish, you can hear the talk twice, if you will, and test out your developing Spanish language skills. For those who are not studying Spanish, please zero in on Gloria's translation of his ideas. The presentation will take somewhere in the neighborhood of 45 to 50 minutes, which will leave us ample time for questions that have been generated by his presentation, and we usually try to wind up somewhat before 9 o'clock. So we ask you to be with us during that time and hopefully learn some interesting stuff this evening. So Gloria Jimenez from Witness for Peace to recognize and introduce our speaker tonight.
Hi, good evening, everyone. So again, my name is Gloria. I'm with Witness for Peace based in Managua, Nicaragua. Witness for Peace has regional offices here in the US. And then we also work in 5 Latin American countries, Nicaragua, Colombia, Mexico, Cuba, and what other one am I missing? Maybe just those 4. But I am part of the international team that works in Nicaragua and Honduras. So our mission as an organization is to change the U.S. Policies and corporate practices that hurt Latin American citizens. We promote justice in Latin America through a change of these policies. And we do work on Honduras because the U.S. has had a very long, sometimes negative history with Honduras, going back to the banana plantations in Honduras, supporting the coup that happened in 2009. There's a lot of U.S. interests, business interests as well in the country. So we do things like bring groups of American citizens to Latin America and to witness what is happening, the effects of these policies. We also bring our partners, like Alfredo, to the U.S. so that you guys can have a direct link to the work that we're doing overseas. I have three handouts for you. One of them, the regional organizer for this region was not able to be here today because we had another Witness for Peace event. There's a blue sheet that talks about the internships that are available with the organizations. If you don't have one, they're over here on that table. And it's a great way to get involved with our organization and possibly get credit for it. Another one is an article about Alfredo López and his work. It's this green one here. And the yellow one, unfortunately, it highlights delegations that don't fall within your breaks. But we hope that future delegations are more accessible to you. And if after this talk you feel excited about the work that we're doing, we hope that you encourage other people in your networks to join us for one of our delegations. Lastly, I'm going to be passing around this sign-in sheet. At the end, we're going to be highlighting some concrete actions that we'd like to propose, and we'd like to hear your ideas as well. But one of the ideas Ofrane, Alfredo's organization, has proposed is signing on to a letter that they're writing to the World Bank to stop funding a development project that, as you'll hear, is displacing their people and creating a lot of difficulties for them. So we'll be circulating that letter if you give us your email, and then we'll just notify you whenever there's an event in the region that you might be interested in. So I'd like to present Alfredo López. He is the vice president of Ofrane, the Black Fraternal Organization of Honduras. And we've been traveling. We started the speaking tour in the Midwest on October 3rd, and we're gonna be going until the 24th of this month, talking to various churches, universities, community centers, people from the Black Lives Movement. So we've had a lot of great conversations. He is somebody that's been part of the strong social movement in Honduras. There are 9 indigenous groups. The Garifuna is definitely one of the strongest. So it's my pleasure to introduce him as tonight's speaker.
Buitiguño, buenas noches a todos y a todas. Y mi nombre es Alfredo López, como lo dijo Gloria, soy el vicepresidente de la Organización Fraternal Negra de Honduras. ¿Quiénes somos realmente los garífunas? Los garífunas realmente, ¿y dónde estamos?
Good evening and good night to everyone. As Gloria mentioned, I'm the vice president of the Black Honduran Organization. And we want to begin by answering the question, who are the Garifuna?
Aquí tenemos un mapa de Honduras, pero antes de arribar a este mapa, nos gustaría decirle que los Garifunas es una mezcla de esclavos negros que venían a los mercados en América Latina. Y en San Vicente hubo una parada obligatoria, y eso lo registra la historia allá en 1600.
So this is a map of Honduras, but I just want to back up and say that the Garifuna people are a mix of intermarriages that happened between slaves that were coming from Africa to Latin America for the slave trade. And our history started in the Caribbean island of St. Vincent around 1600.
Hubo una rebelión en los barcos negreros y estos escaparon a un cayo vecino y allí y llegaron y se quedaron ahí obligadamente porque salieron nadando de los barcos, ¿verdad? Y ahí estaban en malas condiciones y fueron encontrados por estos indígenas, los Kalinas y los Arahuacos.
There was a rebellion on one of these slave boats, and they all fled. They swam to the nearest neighboring island, a tiny island, and that's where they stayed. And they mixed and intermarried with the local indigenous, who are the groups were the Kalinas and the Arawaks.
Quienes los llevaron a la Isla Grande, y ahí pues fue lo que ya explicó Gloria. Y a partir de ahí hubo una vida muy normal entre pueblos. Y de esa mezcla entre estas comunidades surge el pueblo garífuna, que hoy estamos en Honduras, ¿verdad?
And these local indigenous groups brought these Africans to the big island of St. Vincent, where they lived in normal lives in harmony, and that is where the Garifuna, how the Garifuna came to be.
Sin embargo, hay un detalle que no podemos dejar de explicarles a ustedes, que el producto de esta convivencia pacífica, pues, siempre hubieron intentos de los países desarrollados de esclavizar a este pueblo. En esta oportunidad fueron los ingleses que invitaron a los garífunas a someterse como esclavos.
But there is a an important detail. Even though we were living in harmony with the locals there, there was an attempt by the British, in this case, to enslave our people and to try to get us to be subjugated.
Y eso provocó una guerra. Una guerra porque por eso precisamente no llegaron a los mercados. Y esta guerra duró mucho tiempo. Finalmente fueron derrotados y deportados masivamente a British Honduras, hoy Roatán, 1797.
This war was a prolonged one, and it ended by the war was the reason we actually never made it to the slave trade. But we were defeated in this war, and we were massively deported to the Honduran island of Roatán. This was in the year 1797.
Y bueno, desde la llegada a Honduras, está el mapa hondureño. Ellos fueron asentados en toda la costa caribe de Honduras. Hoy en día somos 46 comunidades.
So here you can see a map of Honduras. Since our arrival, we've settled all along the coast of Honduras. And today we are composed of 46 communities.
Que tenemos, colindamos con la Mosquitia en el departamento de Gracias a Dios, y cubrimos toda la costa caribe que viene desde Puerto Cortés y termina, colinda con la Mosquitia. Todo eso es la costa caribe hondureña, lo demás es mar, ¿verdad?
And we're spread, as I said, all along the coast, spreading from Gracias a Dios to Puerto Cortes, which goes into a remote area called La Mosquitia, and the rest of it is, of course, ocean.
¿Por qué? porque ancestralmente nuestros ancestros eran muy buenos pescadores y hasta ahora el principal rubro y la base de nuestra alimentación son los mariscos y el pescado, y somos buenos marineros. En aquel tiempo no había brújula ni GPS, nada, se guiaban por las estrellas y un montón de cosas que tienen que ver con las costumbres ancestrales.
And we are there because our ancestors were traditionally fishermen. We depended on fishing for our subsistence. And at that time, of course, there was no GPS or technology like that. They navigated using the stars, and they used these traditional customs.
Y es importante aclarar, sobre todo a los estudiantes, que nosotros somos un pueblo que nunca dependimos ni dependemos de estados. Siempre fuimos autosuficientes y sacamos de la naturaleza lo que necesitamos. No exterminamos ni el bosque, ni la fauna, ni los peces, sino que todo se hace de manera artesanal.
And it's important for you as students to know that we never depended on governments. We were always very self-sufficient. We also never exploited our natural resources. We used them, but we never exploited them. Our forest, our fish life, our fauna, it was always used by, it was always an artisanal use of these resources.
Ahora, el conflicto ha iniciado a raíz de que estamos en la costa caribe hondureña, donde es playa, sol, todo el año, ¿verdad? Y se necesita para el desarrollo turístico. Y eso plantea un problema.
So this a conflict has arisen precisely because we are on the coast with sun and beach that is there all year round, but our territories are needed to develop tourism, and this has caused a big problem.
Porque nos quieren utilizar como objetos del desarrollo, y nosotros planteamos que deberíamos ser sujetos de desarrollo. Si se va a desarrollar la zona, pues también las personas deberían de avanzar y salir de la discriminación, de la pobreza, de la falta de esperanzas de la gente, y que al final lo que hace es migrar a los países desarrollados.
And, you know, we always insist that we should be objects of development, not objects, but subjects of development. And if there is going to be development on our land, the people should also be benefit from this development. We need to see a decrease in discrimination and poverty and the hopelessness people feel that drive them to do things like migrate to developed countries.
En esta diapositiva, y este es uno de los movilizaciones que hacemos en un territorio nuestro que fue invadido por los narcotraficantes. Pero lo que quiero destacar aquí es la presencia de estos tambores, y para explicarles un poco qué son los tambores y qué significan para nosotros.
On this slide you can see one of many protests that we've done on our territories. This one in particular has to do with the invasion of our land by drug traffickers. But one thing I want to highlight in this picture is the presence of drums. So, and I also want to explain what the significance of the drums is in our culture.
Y nosotros, como pueblos culturalmente diferenciados, y a través de todos estos años de resistencia, hemos podido, con mucho trabajo, mantener nuestra lengua, nuestra cultura, nuestras tradiciones, nuestras raíces están ahí, y de eso nos sentimos muy alegres. Y los tambores son parte importante para nosotros.
Across our history of resistance, with great difficulty, we've been able to maintain our language, our traditions, our culture and roots, and we feel very happy about that. And the drums is an important part of that.
Porque cuando estamos tristes, tocamos los tambores. Cuando estamos alegres, hay fiesta y suenan. Cuando hay emergencia, también suenan para alertar a la gente de que son tiempos de que tenemos que estar alertas porque hay peligro.
We play the drums. They're important because we play the drums when we're happy, when we're sad, and we want to sound the alarm of emergency to alert people to danger.
En este terreno particularmente siguen sonando los tambores porque esa campaña no ha terminado. Empezó hace 3 años. Y ahora apenas estamos viendo algunos logros. Mañana va a estar nuestra presidenta aquí en Iowa recibiendo un premio sobre soberanía alimentaria. Ese es parte del trabajo que hacemos en este territorio.
So on the land where this protest is being held in this picture, this is a campaign that started 3 years ago to remove the drug traffickers off of our land. And there, the drums keep playing. And we've seen some achievements during that time. And in fact, the president of our organization is going to be in Iowa tomorrow, receiving a prize for part of our work, which has been related to food sovereignty.
A pesar de que cuando los narcos disparan sus AK-47 y las R-15, nosotros respondemos con tambores porque somos una comunidad pacífica. Y queremos seguir haciendo nuestros reclamos de manera pacífica y fortaleciendo los lazos de solidaridad con los diferentes países donde tenemos oportunidad de llegar.
So when the drug traffickers shoot their AK-47s and R-15s, we play the drums because we are a peaceful people. And we want to continue to do this to do our work in a nonviolent way, all the while building our ties of solidarity with the different countries where we have the opportunity to visit.
De esa manera estamos haciendo algunos trabajos legales en los diferentes tribunales que tenemos que estar. Los procesos en contra de las comunidades son muchos y permanentes. Y tenemos programas de comunicación como radios. Empezamos con una radio que en 2010 fue incendiada después de las elecciones.
These are the different areas of work we have. We have legal work. We work with the courts related to cases against our communities that always seem to be permanent. We have communications work that we do, including we started off with one radio that in fact was set on fire in 2010 after the elections.
Y ahora, lejos de desanimarnos, hemos instalado 5 más, ahora son 6. Y también acompañamos, como les digo, en la defensa de los derechos humanos a todas nuestras comunidades y somos solidarios con el resto de los 8 pueblos y con nosotros somos 9 en Honduras, todos con los diferentes problemas y amenazas, minería, represa, privatización de los recursos que están en nuestros territorios y que son parte de nuestro hábitat funcional y es propiedad colectiva de los pueblos.
But instead of being discouraged when our radio was set on fire, we installed 5 other ones, and now we have 6 in total. So we work to defend human rights. We work with all of our Garifuna communities, and we're very much in solidarity with the 8 other indigenous groups in Honduras, and with us, that's a total of 9 in the country that exist. And they all have the same types of problems, mining, dams, the privatization of our lands that actually are collectively held land.
Y son miles y miles de dólares, y esa parte quisiera que escucharan con mucha atención, y porque algunos dirán, ¿y qué tiene que ver esto, todos estos problemas con los Estados Unidos o con Europa, la Unión Europea? Pues quiero decirles que está fuertemente ligado a estas políticas públicas que van de aquí y las que están allá en un contexto de corrupción. Pero una corrupción que cada día, lejos de desacelerar, más bien parece que va a levantar vuelo y de una manera exagerada.
And I would like you to listen carefully to this. The fact that millions and millions of dollars come to my country to be part of this problem. You may hear about me talking about all of these problems and say, well, what does it have to do with the European Union or the U.S.? But I want you to know that these public policies, this aid coming from here is playing out in a context, in the Honduran context of corruption. And it's corruption that's, rather than slowing down or diminishing, it's accelerating.
Y mientras tanto, nuestro país se llena de armas, de militares, ¿verdad? El tráfico de droga más bien parece que lo animan, ¿verdad? Entonces, esa es una situación terrible. Mientras en los hospitales no hay medicina, la gente se muere por una aspirina, por una Comen, no hay ni siquiera eso en los hospitales. Instituciones como el Seguro Social, que tienen que ver con la vida de la gente, han sido saqueadas para campañas políticas.
All the while, our country is filled with arms, with military, and it feels like drug trafficking is even being promoted. All the meanwhile, our hospitals do not have medicine, not even something basic like aspirin, and people die over that. And our institutions are ransacked, like the Social Security Institute that has been ransacked to finance political campaigns.
En esta diapositiva miramos al expresidente Pepe Lobo muy contento con otros militares, Y mientras su hijo este año fue está aquí en no sé en qué parte, pero está aquí en Estados Unidos, extraditado por traficante de drogas.
On this slide, you see in the blue shirt, the ex-Honduran president Lobo, surrounded by military men. And this year, I'm not sure where, but somewhere in the U.S., he was extradited because of being a drug trafficker.
Bueno, y la otra habla por sí sola, que posiblemente la candidata está muy contenta con... Esto fue después del golpe, desde luego. Y pero esto solo muestra esa relación muy, muy, como les decía, muy cómoda de parte de la primera potencia del mundo con estas personas que no son más que unos corruptos, gente del crimen organizado en nuestro país, ligados a la política.
I think the other picture with Clinton speaks for itself. This was taken after the coup, and it shows, I'm not sure how to describe the relationship, close, comfortable, and it's this relationship by the U.S. is with corrupt people, and you know, organized crime in our country is very tied to politics.
Y esto. Y los resultados, como les decía, va a ser más migración, más pérdida de nuestro territorio, más amenazas en contra de pueblos, como en este caso el pueblo garífuna, que el 2001 la UNESCO declaró este pueblo Patrimonio Cultural de la Humanidad, porque a través de tantos años, más de 2000 años de resistencia, hemos podido mantener nuestra lengua, nuestras tradiciones y nuestra cultura.
All the while the threats continue. We see the consequences being more immigration, a loss of our territory. And we've been in resistance for over 2,000 years, and we've maintained our language, our tradition, our cultures, and that's why in 2001 UNESCO recognized our culture as an intangible contribution to humanity.
Sin embargo, miramos en la otra, el otro. La otra fotografía, soldados norteamericanos enseñándole a disparar a los hondureños. Y nosotros no estamos en guerra. Lo que hay es un descontento de la gente que estamos en las calles protestando. Entonces, estos disparos, muchos de estos disparos han eliminado vidas de hondureños y compañeros nuestros, ¿verdad? Y ese es uno de los pesares más grandes. Además de los escuadrones de la muerte que después de antes del golpe ya estaban en Honduras.
This other picture shows U.S. soldiers training Honduran soldiers how to shoot, and but this is, you know, this doesn't affect the situation of the great unhappiness there is in. With Hondurans who go out in the street to protest. In fact, perhaps these they're learning to shoot, or they're aiming at us, because many of my brothers and sisters have been killed in this struggle, and the death squads are there in Honduras, and they've been there since before the coup in 2009.
Y Mr. Chomsky dice que, bueno, que la lucha contra las drogas es para criminalizar a los pobres. Y eso es cierto. Nosotros estuvimos 6 años en la cárcel, 6 años y 6 meses. Tuvo que intervenir la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, por eso estoy aquí hablando con ustedes.
And Professor Chomsky in this picture says the drug war is used to criminalize the poor. And that's true. I was in jail for 6 years and 6 months and under drug trafficking charges, and the international court had to intervene so that I could be freed and be here with you today.
Hablando un poco sobre los efectos, ya dije algunas cosas. Y migración, la pérdida de territorio, criminalización de los movimientos sociales, toda esta ayuda que muchas veces para los que son estudiantes norteamericanos, sus padres, sus parientes, pagan impuestos, ¿verdad? Para esa excusa de la seguridad y la defensa, seguridad, defensa, no tenemos ni seguridad ni defensa.
Here on this slide, you see a lot of the effects that I've already spoken about, more immigration, a loss of our territory, and all this aid and resources that goes to my country. It's important for you as American students to know that your parents, your family, your families pay taxes for this aid to go towards quote unquote defense and security. But I can tell you we neither feel protected or secure.
Que todas esas armas, como no estamos en guerra, entonces los policías están preparados para reprimir y matar gente. Y como estamos en la calle, eso es para nosotros, ¿verdad? Para reprimirnos a nosotros, que estamos reclamando justicia, que estamos reclamando un sistema, un verdadero sistema de democracia. Estamos pidiendo que se elimine la corrupción, y eso es un pecado. In our country.
Because all of these arms, since we're not at war, they end up going to help repress us and to kill us. Because we are the ones out on the streets demanding justice, demanding a democratic system, and an end to corruption. And in Honduras, this is a sin, essentially.
Y esta partecita es parte de nuestra realidad. Este es un pueblo miskito. Expliqué dónde quedan los miskitos. Los miskitos es un departamento con muchos recursos, mucha agua, pero no hay carreteras. No hay ahí lo que hay son bases militares de los norteamericanos y mucho tráfico de cosas ilegales, ¿verdad? Pero no es la comunidad. Esta fotografía muestra una situación muy terrible que pasó, ¿sí?
This other picture shows a part of what our reality looks like. I explained earlier where the Miskitia is. It's a state that is very rich in resources but doesn't have roads. And what it does have a lot of is American military bases and a lot of trafficking of illegal goods. This picture shows something terrible that happened there.
Hubo una confusión de parte de la DEA de una lancha de personas civiles que fueron ametrallados, confundidos con narcotraficantes. Y murieron 6 personas, incluso 2 mujeres embarazadas. Entonces, esto para nosotros es inaceptable, ¿verdad?
There was a civilian boat carrying people who were going about their daily chores, and there was a confusion on the part of the U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency. This civilian boat was attacked. The DEA believed they were drug traffickers. 6 people were killed, 2 of them pregnant women. So for us, this is something that's very unacceptable.
Y sucede regularmente. El asunto es que y esto es crítico, para nosotros, porque toda esta culturas de los otros pueblos, que somos 9, todo este trabajo que hacemos y todo esto que se mantiene vivo está basado en principios que tienen que ver con la solidaridad, la hermandad entre nosotros y el respeto a la dignidad de las personas, ¿verdad? Pero cuando sucede esto contra un compañero, es como que no está sucediendo a nosotros.
And sadly, this is a regular occurrence. That's why it's critical for us. So there's something fundamental that that unites all of our 9 indigenous groups in Honduras. And it's that we maintain our cultures alive through solidarity, through brotherhood, and demanding respect for dignity. And when something like this happens to one of us, it's like it happened to all of us.
Por eso es que no podemos dejar de denunciar estas cosas.
That's why we can't stop denouncing things like this one that happened.
Y para dejar un poco espacio, porque yo sé que seguramente van a haber muchas preguntas y que vamos a tratar de contestar. Y quisiera terminar con este último tema que tiene que ver con las cosas puntuales que hacemos, que estamos haciendo.
I'll end with this slide that touches on some specific work we do. I know that there will be many questions, and I hope I can answer them.
El día 9 de octubre se iniciaron unas reuniones de la Corte Interamericana de Derechos Humanos para resolver 2 casos que llevamos un poco más de 24 años discutiendo en las cortes internacionales. Y ahora hemos llegado estamos al final y estamos esperando la sentencia sobre el caso Triunfo de la Cruz en contra de Honduras y Punta Piedra, que es otra comunidad garífuna, en contra de Honduras.
On the 9th of October, the Inter-American Court on Human Rights began their meeting to review and put out a ruling for these 2 cases listed here that have taken over 24 years to finally arrive at this point where we're now awaiting a resolution. And those are the 2 cases are Triunfo de la Cruz versus Honduras and Punta Piedra versus Honduras.
Como pueden ver, parece una novela, ¿verdad? 24 años es bastante tiempo. Algunos hermanos míos están muertos, otros se enfermaron, otros fueron asesinados, pero estamos nosotros todavía para poder recibir esto, y ojalá que sea a favor de nosotros. No sabemos todavía si vamos a ganar o no.
As you can see, it's like a soap opera, the fact that it's taken this long. And in this period, I've had colleagues who have died, others who have been killed. But we are finally here to see this ruling, and we don't know what's going to happen. We hope that it'll be in our favor, but we just don't know.
Y hay otro caso que es mucho más reciente, que tiene que ver con las charter cities. Y vamos a explicar qué son las charter cities.
There's another case that has arisen very recently, and it has to do with something called charter cities, and we're going to explain what that is.
Las charter cities es zonas especiales de desarrollo que están fueron creadas en la mente de un economista norteamericano, se llama Paul Romer. No sé de qué estado es, pero es norteamericano.
Charters are special development zones that will be created, and they were this concept was dreamed up by an American economist by the name of Paul Romer.
Entonces Paul Romer ha vendido la idea a nuestro gobierno de que en estas zonas especiales de desarrollo que se crean tienen que haber ahí su propia, tiene que haber un gobernador, tiene que haber su propia policía, sus propios militares, sus propios jueces, y es una, es un estado dentro de otro estado, que ya es una ley en nuestro país.
Paul Romer then went and sold the idea to the government of Honduras. And these charter cities will have their own governor, their own police, their own military and judges, their own courts. And now it's actually a law in our country.
Y Paul Romer va a ser uno de los gobernadores de estas zonas de desarrollo.
And Paul Romer is actually, has just been named one of the governors for these charter cities.
El asunto es que están nuestras comunidades dentro de la primera zona especial de desarrollo. Y hubieron cuatro jueces en primera instancia de la Corte Suprema Hondureña que dijeron que eso no se podía hacer, pero fueron despedidos.
And the problem is that our community is located where one of the first special development zone will be established. And four judges who were voting on this law actually said, no, we can't do that. But they were fired.
Y llamaron a otros cuatro para que aprobaran la ley que ahora tenemos.
And what they did was bring in four new judges who would approve this as a law.
Por eso es que la Corte está conociendo ese caso y también va a haber una resolución sobre el despido ilegal de esos cuatro jueces. Porque según el modelo que tenemos, la democracia se sostiene bajo tres poderes, tres, ejecutivo, legislativo y judicial, para los que están estudiando leyes acá.
So now the international court is reviewing this case that has to do with the illegal firing of these judges. And supposedly, for those of you, as those of you who are studying law know, there should be three powers, the executive, judicial, and legislative.
Pero en Honduras, el poder judicial y el poder legislativo son mandaderos del presidente que está ahorita en el poder y está apoyado por su gobierno, lamentablemente.
But in Honduras, the judicial and the legislative branch is controlled by the executive, and the current president that we have is unfortunately supported by the U.S. government.
Y finalmente, por razones de tiempo, queremos, estos son algunos de los productos, producto de que en Honduras está lleno de palma africana, los narcotraficantes. Es la manera de lavar el dinero, lavar activos. Compran los terrenos de las comunidades y siembran palma africana. Y el producto de palma africana se vende aquí. Creo que muchos de ustedes son consumidores. Pero la verdad es que están haciendo mucho daño. No solo en Honduras, queremos decirles eso, ¿verdad? En otros países también.
Finally, I want to end with this slide that shows products that contain African palm oil. This African palm oil is actually used a lot by drug traffickers to launder money. They buy up our land And many of these products, I'm sure you consume on a daily basis, but this money laundering that happens is not only in Honduras, but in many countries.
Por eso, para nosotros es importante algunas cosas que pueden ir sucediendo. Cuando ustedes se dan cuenta muchas de en qué se gastan sus impuestos y supuestamente para ayudar a los pobres, pero lejos de ayudar a estos pobres, como su servidor que está aquí hablando con ustedes, más bien es un gran daño que le están haciendo a mi pueblo, porque si tan solo pudiesen plantear una lucha frontal contra la corrupción, y eso significaría menos migración para acá, significaría más medicina en los hospitales, significaría más educación para nuestros jóvenes. Y estoy hablando no solo de Honduras, Guatemala, El Salvador. Ustedes saben que el presidente de Guatemala está preso por eso.
So finally, I want to say that hopefully you realize that a lot of your taxes, when they go to supposedly help countries like mine, they do all the opposite. They cause great harm, and not just in Honduras, in many places. So if there was a frontal attack that was done to combat corruption, we would see a decrease in migration and an increase in the supply of medicines in our hospital, and better quality education for our young people. But you know, like I said, it's not just in Honduras. It's also this situation is the same in other countries like Guatemala. And if you've heard the news recently, what the president of Guatemala has just been put in jail precisely because of corruption.
Y no nos vamos a cansar hasta ver al presidente nuestro también. Ojalá que lo extraditen para acá y que no vuelva a salir. Muchísimas gracias y estamos listos para las preguntas.
And we're not going to stop until we see our own president in jail. I want to just say thank you very much, and we're going to open it up now to questions.
Have been concise and precise about their time and presentation to leave space for you to ask questions. So please, we are now in the question and answer period. Yes, back here first and then over here.
All right, in what specific ways do Ofrena and Witness for Peace work together regarding all of these issues? I just introduced, they seem kind of separate, so I want to know how they're coming together.
The question was about how Witness for Peace and Ofrane work together on these issues.
Bueno, seguir trabajando juntos para poder sonar los tambores de alarma. Nosotros, los tambores nuestros están sonando. Seguramente también hay otras organizaciones que están ligados a este trabajo y sin duda alguna vamos a seguir con Witness for Peace, que vengan otros, que hablen también, que cuenten desde su perspectiva lo que está pasando, no quedarnos sentados solo observando la destrucción de nuestros pueblos y ustedes disfrutando de todas las cosas buenas que dicen los medios que están haciendo con esos recursos allá. Tenemos que, eso es lo que planteamos, estrechando estos lazos de solidaridad permanentemente para que sonar la alarma.
Well, Ofrane and Witness for Peace will continue working to sound the alarm on these issues with our drums. And we hope that Witness for Peace will bring others to come and talk about these issues from their perspective, because we're not going to sit idle and watch the destruction of our communities, while you over on this side only hear the good things from the corporate media that is supposedly done with aid. And we're going to continue building ties of solidarity permanently. I will answer on behalf of Witness for Peace. As I said, we take groups of Americans to countries where we work to see and witness firsthand the work that we're doing. And, you know, people who go on the delegations span the spectrum of people who are just interested and want to learn more to very experienced organizers and activists, and they come back and do solidarity work here. For example, in this next page, we in the countries where we work, we always support our partners. What we do on the ground is led by our partners. So you see here on the third point that Ofrane is writing an open letter to the World Bank to stop funding a tourism project that is negatively affecting their communities. So that's the type of work we do, advocacy, disseminating information, taking delegations to Honduras, bringing speakers here, and also doing human rights accompaniment work in the various countries where we work.
Yeah, let me explain what human rights accompaniment work is, because I think that's really the origin of the Witness for Peace organization that I connected with more than 30 years ago. It's basically the idea that if an indigenous organization such as this is known to and supported by human rights activists and just average citizens in the United States, and it's an organization that's potentially facing legal challenges or worse from the government in which they are located, in the country in which they're located, the idea really is that that government may think twice about taking really harsh actions against them, knowing that the wider world community is watching. That's what human rights accompaniment means, and it's something that in many ways Witness for Peace started with its work in Nicaragua in the 1980s and has blossomed really into a worldwide movement that is often based with groups that are based either in the United States or Europe, giving this kind of support to groups doing human rights work abroad. There's a question in the back there, and then one up front, and then there. Yes. Yes, you first.
Okay. There's a group of us Indian that are going on a nursing study abroad trip to Belize, and from what we've been taught, there's a large amount of Rifna people residing in Belize. Is that due to the immigration of the drug war or just immigration over time?
No, realmente eso fue migración. Muchos de nuestros hermanos cuando llegamos a Honduras siguieron migrando buscando mejores posibilidades. Algunos se quedaron en Guatemala. No tiene nada que ver con las drogas. La droga es reciente. Y muchos se fueron para Belice, Dangriga, Atkin, pero son parientes nuestros, somos los mismos. Y algunos regresaron un poco para Nicaragua, pero allá ha sido mermado este pueblo, han perdido la lengua. Estamos tratando de rehacer un proyecto para ir a apoyarlos, pero estamos lejos todavía de... Estamos muy ocupados acá tratando de sobrevivir.
This migration happened long ago. It happened when we first arrived to Honduras. Some of the Garifuna people kept migrating, and they moved into other countries like Belize, and also, you know, they're, so this has nothing to do with the drug war. This has been a new issue that has come up. But we have many family members there in some of these countries, and some even Garifuna people even migrated into Nicaragua. but the Garifuna there are kind of weak. They've lost their language, and we're trying to establish a project where we help them kind of strengthen their cultural traditions, but we're also very busy ourselves just trying to survive.
I think the map could have included a wider piece there, and so basically you really have the Garifuna people all the way from Nicaragua to Honduras, even in Guatemala, and then in Belize, the country that was once known as British Honduras. So it's that really that whole area that is along a narrow strip along the coast. And so I think you will find some interesting things when you get to Belize and to engage with that community. Question is down here in the front, and then here.
Primero, muchas gracias por venir a nuestra universidad. Mi pregunta es de los dos casos que están en la corte internacionales, de qué se tratan esos casos y por qué son de tan importancia.
The question was about the first. He said thank you for coming to our university. And he wants to know a little bit more about the two cases that the Garifuna have in the international court system.
El primero puntapiedra en contra del Estado de Honduras fue un militar que promoviendo invasiones ilegales de supuestos campesinos se metieron al terreno de la comunidad de Puntapiedra. Y no ha habido manera de sacarlo porque luego estos campesinos, supuestos campesinos, le vendieron a los narcotraficantes. Y ahora, en vez de campesinos, tenemos una invasión de gente muy poderosa que el gobierno no quiso tratar el asunto y ahora por eso lo llevamos a la corte. Y esta...
The second case listed here, Punta Piedra versus Honduras, is related to a man in the military, in the Honduran military, who essentially promoted the invasion of our lands. He sold some of our lands supposedly to campesinos who were in fact drug traffickers. And our Honduran government didn't want to deal or resolve this case, so it moved on to through the international courts.
Y este año tuvimos la audiencia y esa audiencia fue en el Paraguay y ahorita es que se va a conocer la sentencia final. El otro caso es Triunfo de la Cruz versus Honduras, que tiene mucho que ver con el primer caso que ya perdió el Estado, que es el caso Alfredo López en contra del Estado de Honduras, y que ahora es un reclamo sobre el territorio ancestral de la comunidad, ¿verdad?, de Triunfo de la Cruz, que pretenden desarrollar el Cancún hondureño en la bahía de Tela.
And this trial for Punta Piedra versus Honduras happened earlier in Paraguay, and now we're awaiting the ruling. The first case, Triunfo de la Cruz versus Honduras, relates to my own case that was in the international court system, Alfredo López versus Honduras. But this case also has more broadly to do with our ancestral land that the government wants to develop, and essentially what they want to do is recreate a new Cancun in the Honduran Bay of Tela.
Cancun's the Mexican resort city. Next question's here in front.
¿Cuál es la evidencia?
I'm translating her question in English. I am Honduran. I came here 5 years ago precisely because I know about the corruption in Honduras, although I'm not updated with what's happening there now. So I want to know, what evidence is there that President Orlando, the current Honduran president, is in fact corrupt?
Gracias de saludarte. Y bueno, hay pruebas. Primero, dije que han saqueado las instituciones como el Seguro Social, que tienen que ver con la salud de la gente, de los trabajadores. Ellos han organizado empresas ficticias para financiar la campaña, por eso él está sentado ahí en la silla presidencial ahora. 7,000 millones de lempiras para una campaña política y hay cheques que se están presentando a diario. ¿Sabe qué justificó él? Que si eso era, se probaba, que ellos iban a devolver el dinero. Pero ya murieron un montón de gente porque no hay medicina en los hospitales.
First, greetings to you. I mentioned earlier that our Honduran institutions have been ransacked, including the equivalent of our Social Security Department, and this has to do with people's health. The government has also set up fake companies to finance their political campaigns. They ransacked seven million lempiras. They took 7 billion from the Social Security Institute to finance his political campaign, and they have said that if it's found that they did in fact steal this money, that they will give the money back. But that doesn't change the fact that people have already died because they didn't have the medicine, because the Social Security Institute didn't have the medicine for them.
Y para darles una idea, ¿por qué nosotros creemos que debe ir preso? Hay una familia de traficantes, de narcotraficantes, extraditados aquí en Honduras, la familia Valle de Santa Rosa de Copán, muy famosos. Ellos financiaron la campaña del presidente actual, del que está hablando la joven, para que él no pudiera permitir la extradición de esa persona, de esos individuos. Y un policía honesto que había, siempre hay alguien, capturó a estas personas y los extraditaron. Ese policía fue despedido inmediatamente por Juan Orlando Hernández.
To give you an idea of why I say our president should be jailed, there is a very powerful family, Honduran family, called the Valle family. They are, in fact, drug traffickers, and they have financed the presidential campaign. And there was an honest police officer that turned them in. And they were extradited. They were consequently extradited to the U.S. But our president ended up firing this police officer.
Y los narcotraficantes están dando toda la información. El problema es que no sabemos cuándo va a pasar algo, pero seguramente puede ser que así funciona el sistema. Vamos a ver.
And now the drug traffickers are talking, and we don't know what's going to happen in this case, but that's how the system works.
Just one addition to that piece of it. you may ask, you know, why do you need so much money to run a campaign in a small country? And that is because in the last presidential election, really for the first time in Honduran history, there actually were social movements that organized a political movement that was threatening to actually vote out the traditional political party, something that has happened across Latin America and even in Central America, next door in El Salvador, for example. So really for the first time, that traditional political party felt the need that it had to run a very slick campaign in order to convince the people to keep them in office. So in some ways, ironically, the fact that they were stealing this money was a complement to the movements that were rising up against them. That's my own interpretation. Other questions? Yes, here and then here.
Often in Latin America, we see that the church is a very powerful institution. Could you speak about maybe any support that you've received from the church in Honduras?
In this, we have a lot of good relationship with the church, because sometimes the church is not bad. The bad is the people who are running those institutions. Tenemos un cardenal que dice que el Papa es comunista, ¿verdad? Entonces, ya pueden ustedes entender, pero no toda la iglesia piensa así.
We have a cardinal who says the Pope is a communist, so you get the idea, you can imagine what we're dealing with. But we do have other allies within the religious community that are good.
Y nosotros sentimos un gran respeto por el Papa, y es un hombre, es un ilustre personaje que esperamos que pueda hacer la diferencia, independientemente de lo que piensen algunos sacerdotes allá en nuestro país.
The Pope is someone and is an illustrious person. We have a lot of respect for him, and we know that, or we hope that he can make a difference despite what our own priest may think or say. So the question was about the charter cities, if there's a lot of support amongst the Honduran population for charter cities, and for Paul Romer specifically.
Hay mucha oposición, y parte de eso es que los tambores nuestros están ahí sonando, y los movimientos sociales desde luego no apoyan eso, pero hay mucha intimidad, por eso la militarización, por eso la excusa de apoyar la seguridad y enseñarle a los soldados a disparar para matar la gente que reclame. Y hay un proceso de intimidación de los movimientos sociales. Estamos vigilados permanentemente por los escuadrones de la muerte, y creo que en eso van en eso va a estar la fortaleza para consolidar la idea. Ojalá que la corte pueda fallar a favor de los jueces y hondureños que decidieron de acuerdo a lo que está pasando en el país, pero estamos ante una dictadura.
There is a great opposition to these charter cities, and part of the reason is that our drums are playing. Certainly the civil society in Honduras doesn't support this, and that's why we have militarization in our country. And so, I'm sorry, I lost my thought here. So that's why we're permanently watched by the death squads, and we think that this is part of the strategy of the government to consolidate support for these charter cities. But we hope that the international court will rule against the government and reinstitute these judges, because what we're dealing with in Honduras is a dictatorship.
Yeah, how crucial do you feel it is that your movement, your works, remain peaceful?
El pueblo, voy a hablar por el pueblo garífuno. Nosotros como somos, estamos en Honduras producto de una expulsión por violencia. El pueblo ha renunciado totalmente a la violencia. Hubo mucha violencia con la pérdida de esta guerra con los ingleses. Y ustedes no tienen idea de las cosas que hemos tenido conocimiento producto de esa guerra.
Well, I'll speak for the Garifuna. We were a product of a violent expulsion from our land. So we denounce violence. We had great losses due to the war with England, and we've learned a lot from that experience.
Y todavía estamos recabando mucha información, y por eso es que entendemos el carácter pacífico del pueblo garífuna hoy, ¿verdad? Que muchas veces mucha gente coge hasta ventaja, pero la verdad es que nosotros como pueblos vamos a defendernos. Pero ¿cómo nos vamos a defender? En base a los convenios y tratados internacionales que se han firmado los gobiernos con la intención de no obedecer, pero los tenemos que obligar porque somos directamente los interesados.
And we're still capturing lessons learned and information from that experience of being in war. That's why we have this nonviolent characteristic to our culture, and we find it a great feature. So how do we defend ourselves? Well, we defend ourselves with treaties, with international treaties and agreements that, although our government signs, they do not fulfill and respect. But we have to force them to comply, because we are the ones that are being affected.
You know, just to add maybe to that, Latin America in some sense had a long history of civil society movements, including in Nicaragua, that did take up arms and did achieve some things through that. But the tide has really turned in the last 25 years or so, that movements for social change, like this organization from Honduras and many others, have found other ways to proceed, including through the ballot box of getting a progressive governments elected to power that fundamentally change a country's thrust and role in the world and toward its own population. That's happened in countries like Bolivia and Ecuador and others in South America. And even if they're not able to do that, they're able to use and to utilize organizations like Witness for Peace and other non-governmental organizations and international human rights organizations and structures like the Inter-American Court to move forward their agenda. So I understand the question. It's a very good one. Other questions? We have time for... Actually, I think since I don't see a hand, and we have one more thing that Gloria would like to do, for those of you that have stayed here to the end, I will turn it back over to her. But thank you for your questions.
Yeah, I just wanted to go over quickly this slide, because I think a lot of people listen to Alfredo's story and have a desire to do something. There was a previous slide Here, if you can only do one thing, help us disseminate this information. A lot of people don't know what U.S. taxes are being used for, so if you can post something on your social media page, that would be great. Other things that you can do, there's a plan, the Biden plan that proposes $1 billion for the Northern Triangle countries of Honduras, Nicaragua, and Guatemala. And it's proposed for 2016. And as you have heard, there's a lot of corruption in not only Honduras, but in other countries in the region. So we don't consider this a good use of US taxes. The other thing that Alfredo and Alfredo's organization has asked us to do, and many of our partners tell us, is we want the US public to advocate for a just U.S. foreign policy. What does that look like? Free and fair elections, community ownership of natural resources, and prior consultation when projects are being proposed in their communities. And also for us to monitor U.S. funds that are going to governments and our support of their military. I already mentioned the letter of Alfredo's organization is preparing. You can certainly join a delegation to Honduras to learn in depth the situation there and ways that we can support social movements there. So I also listed the two websites that you can go to for more information.
Okay, my deepest thanks to Gloria and Alfredo for coming and sharing the evening with us. I very much appreciate that they've been here. Is a way of maybe refocusing all of your thoughts on this, especially to some of my students who are here from the international relations class. Be sure to take away the green sheet, which sort of summarizes and lets you think a little more about what was said here tonight. But let's finish with a round of applause for everybody.